Good Friday afternoon. Welcome to another edition of the Grio Live.
Yes, we made it to the end of the week. I hope you guys are feeling as good as I'm feeling. We're going to talk about some of today's trending stories. We want to hear from you guys. Let us know where you're tuning in and let your voice be heard. What do you think about today's stories? We want to hear from you.
Yeah, we have some really important stories, especially one of the top stories coming out of Washington, D.C. Yes. About Black and Latino teenagers who have gone missing. So stay tuned for that story. We're going to get into it very soon. Mm-hmm. But as always, we open our show with the caption, this photo of the day. It connects to some story you will see later on. So take a look. Try to come up with some witty commentary around this picture.
Now, I want you guys to make this one good because...
Yes, I want jokes on jokes for this photo.
Let this be the best caption this photo we've had thus far.
Seriously. So remember that photo. Write down whatever comments you want to put about that photo.
Natasha, I want to hear you come up with something really funny.
Oh my goodness. Give me a second. I will think about it.
Okay, I'm going to think about mine too.
Absolutely. And we want to shout out some of our favorite commenters who always come back to the show. Ivory, Charlene, Jeff, all in the building. Always good to see you in the comments. If you are new to our stream, let us know where you're tuning in from and comment throughout the show.
Yes, join the fam.
All right. So we're going to start with a follow-up to a story that we did earlier this week. If you recall, there was a viral fight video that just it got millions and millions of views. And it wasn't for the usual reason. Usually we see kids fighting in the street. People put it up because they want to celebrate the violence. But this time, a good Samaritan stepped in.
Yes.
He broke up the fight. And he gave a valuable lesson about what it means to be a leader and to have empathy and to, you know, hope for the best. And so he was honored by the city council in Atlantic City in New Jersey. Let's take a look at what he had to say about all of this fame and attention for his good deeds.
People get 15 minutes of fame a lot. And I would like to use every second of the 15 minutes to send gratitude to my mother.
One thing I always told them in making decisions, think about the best thing that can happen and the worst thing that can happen, because either side has consequences.
So I want to say thank you again.
I hope that this is something that will influence people to do more character building.
Wow.
That's beautiful.
It's beautiful. Did you see the tears in his eyes?
Oh, he made me want to cry.
I mean, what a powerful example of manhood, you know, being strong and being kind to others and being a leader. And he talked about the fact that when he was young, he grew up in the projects and he would get in trouble sometimes. And his mother would tell him to go into the room and read. That was that would be his punishment.
Right. She didn't whoop him.
She didn't whoop him.
She made him read.
She taught him important lessons. Yes. And so now he's passing that forward. And what I also liked about this was that he invited the two young men who were in the fight video to be a part of, you know, the sort of honors that he was getting. And he said, these two young men, they're the example, because even though everybody was watching them and telling them to fight, they still shook hands with each other, no matter what the crowd was saying, you know? And it's always somebody in the crowd trying to tell you to do wrong, but it takes integrity to stand up and fight against that.
And the greatest lesson is that it's never too late to turn things around. They started fighting, and that wasn't wrong, that was wrong to do, but then they decided not to continue fighting after they got some words of wisdom. And so it's never too late to, if you did something bad in life, there's redemption. And I love redemption stories. I love stories that challenge the toxic masculinity like we talked about earlier.
Oh yes.
And it's just beautiful. This is what true manhood looks like, and I want to see more men like this around the world.
Absolutely. This comment comes from Loretta. Loretta says, "What a wonderful young man." And this is from Tracia. Tracia said, "That brother is to be commended. Good job, New Jersey."
Yes.
Big shout out to New Jersey.
Yes.
I think in every community there are men like this man who, you know, are their fathers, their sons, their brothers, and they're doing good works, and maybe there's not a camera to capture it every single time, but it's happening. And so I just hope that more people are inspired to do that.
Yeah.
Charlene says, yes, indeed. I so respect that brother, and the props he gave to his mother are priceless, and the young men are special too. There's always a mom out there, you know what I'm saying,
always,
who gets credit for doing good things. So
mothers are the backbone of our communities.
They really are. Yeah. Ivory Scott says, we need more men and women to take this type of stand, and I completely agree.
And we need more city councils. We need more people from the, from our legislature to honor community members who do good. It's not just about policing and all the bad things. We have to celebrate and acknowledge the good things, too.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I hope everybody is inspired in their own way. And I'm seeing some new cities in the feed, so I want to take a second to shout them out. Tori Anthony is tuning in from St. Louis. Shout out to the Midwest. And Tracy is actually in Maryland, and this some of the stories that we're covering have to do with Baltimore, Maryland, Virginia area. And Pamela is back. She's from Allentown, Pennsylvania.
Awesome.
Oh, and Loretta is from Atlanta.
Hey, I went to school in Atlanta, Morehouse.
Always shout out to Morehouse. Good stuff. So now we want to talk a little bit about what's happening in Washington, D.C. Lawmakers are starting to speak up, and they're calling for the FBI to investigate this pattern of young people going missing in the Washington, D.C. area. It's been alarming. Now, the D.C. police insist that these numbers are not any higher than years before. They said that they're about consistent. It's remained about 2,000 teens going missing a year. They say it hasn't spiked, but it's still very concerning. Within the past 3 months, you've had, I think it was about 500 who've gone missing. Wow. 22 still, the cases have not been solved. And so people are saying, where are these young missing teens? What is happening to them? And why aren't people paying more attention? Mm. What do you think about this? Why do you think it's taken so long, both for you all and for you, Gerren? Why do you think it's taken so long for people to pay attention to this case?
Well, there's a lack of care. I mean, is it surprising that if communities of color are often ignored, whether it's education, economic, social issues, so it's not surprising that if someone goes missing from these very same communities, that police and state prosecutors and everyone else don't do enough to find the girls. There's a lack of care for Black and Latino people, but particularly girls in this case where they're missing. And I think there's always an assumption that Black people are like superhuman, that we can never be victims in that. So usually I think there's an assumption that they ran away or they wanted to be gone rather than they may be victims of something else. And it is the job of investigators to ask these questions and find the answers.
And even if you've had a troubled past, maybe you were a runaway in the past, it doesn't mean that you're not being victimized right now.
Exactly.
If you look at some of these human sex trafficking numbers, the statistics show that 40.4% of victims of human trafficking. So if you're not familiar with that term, human trafficking, some people refer to it as prostitution or being pimped out in some sort of way. Mm-hmm. But it's a crime. And the many of the women and young men are victims. You know, they are not willing participants. Somebody abuses them or manipulates them. And 40.4% of victims are Black women, in comparison with white women, which is 26%. And this was from our report that we read today. So, you know, I think that there's a lot more to it. It's not just about people running away. And in some cases, there are people who are being abused. And that makes the one child missing is too many children who are gone from their homes.
Yeah. And we've seen cases where young girls of color go missing, not because they were kidnapped per se, but because they've met some man online who's older and manipulative, and they think that they're leaving their home to be with this with their boyfriend, if you will, and then things turn bad sometimes. And so there's so many different cases, and each individual case is going to be different, but they all matter, and they all should matter.
And you know, I actually saw a report about the fact that this is we can't make assumptions that this just happens in inner cities, and many suburban youth are targeted as well. They're right at home on the internet, you know, talking to some sort of stranger who is manipulating them, telling them to come meet them in a certain place, and then they're gone, and the parents don't know what to do. And I remember, I think I had to be like 15. That was when the internet, like the early days, like AOL.
Yeah,
we're
millennials, but we're kind of like in the
middle. Right on the edge. But I remember being a 15-year-old girl, and my parents didn't know what we were doing on the internet. Mm-hmm. They didn't know about chat rooms. I mean, I knew more about how to manipulate the internet and meet people than they did. And there were some scary people that actually were messaging me that when I look back, I'm like, those
people. It was
people,
so dangerous. I did the same thing. You got chat rooms.
Predators.
Yeah.
That now you look back and you're like, oh my God, I would be so afraid.
You were so susceptible. And
absolutely.
Now they're even more susceptible. It's everyone's online. Everyone's on social media.
Yes, absolutely. And some of our commenters are chiming in about this. And Tracia says it's probably happening all over and we have to keep a light on it. And I agree. It can't be a thing that becomes so normal that we don't care.
Yeah.
Charlene says this is happening in the Bronx with Latino girls as well. And I did see a report about that they actually busted up a human trafficking ring that had been, you know, basically taking advantage of these girls. Sometimes in they're training hotel workers now to keep an eye out for certain signs of abuse. So that way, if, you know, victims are meeting up with people who are taking advantage of them, they can kind of have a sense and report it to authorities.
And we all should be vigilant. Like, I think in New York especially, we walk to home, to the train station, and we're so one-track minded. But there's so much going on around the world. It's important for us. If we're going to be parts of the community, we have to pay attention to what was going on, because we may miss something glaring that could save a young girl's life.
Yeah. And, you know, oftentimes people are reluctant to talk about race. They always say, well, why? What does it have to do with race? This happens to everyone. But the truth is that when it comes to media attention, there's often a difference in the type of attention that is given to young people of color when they're gone versus people who are not of color, so to speak.
Yeah.
So think about the JonBenet Ramseys of the world or Elizabeth Smart. Those cases got a lot of attention right away, and they sort of took over, you know, the mainstream.
They have
media
TV
news
specials
cycle.
And movies.
Movies, all
There's
of
nothing
those
like that for a girl of color.
Yes, and so it connects, and it's very complicated, and I think it connects to history and the way that, you know, we sort of value different lives, or different lives have been valued in this country. But I don't think there's anything wrong with calling out the fact that because of, you know, their ethnicity, in many ways they can be overlooked, and for that reason we have to give them extra attention.
Yes,
for sure.
Agreed.
Well,
here's to hoping that, you know, members of Congress and local politicians speaking up. It obviously is getting more attention now, and maybe this will kind of springboard and help inspire or coerce the FBI director, the attorney general, to do something from a federal level.
Yep, and the FBI just really wants to figure out whether this is a pattern or if this is just, you know, an anomaly that's going on. So we will continue to follow this story, but again, if you want more information, the National Crime Information Center. And if you're on Twitter, you can follow the D.C. Police Department. They've been tweeting out photos of the girls who have gone missing. And when they find somebody, they also let you know that that person has been found safe and out of harm's way. So you can go ahead and follow them for more information as well.
Yes.
All right. Well, so we're talking about people who have actually been abducted and are going through, you know, who are missing. And it's a serious issue. Unfortunately, we have a story of somebody who claimed that they were kidnapped, made up a huge story about it, and turns out it was all one big lie. You want to break it down for us?
Yes. So a young lady, her name is Brianna Harmon Talbot. She reported that to her fiance, she's 18 years old, told her fiance that she had been abducted and that she was raped by three black men. She reappeared in a Texas church, and she interrupted a service. She was wearing only a shirt, bra, and underwear with scratches visible to her skin, and she claimed that she had been abducted. So then later on, after investigators were like, we don't know if this story, it seems a little fishy, she admitted that she made the whole thing up. And obviously, had this advanced any further, she could have possibly put three innocent black men to prison or jail for something that they did not do.
Well, she already put him at risk just by telling police that she'd been raped by three black men. So right away, they're looking for those suspects.
Right.
And it was quite disrespectful to the community. And also, how are you going to... I'm sorry. I need a second.
Get it out, Tasha.
How do you walk into a church knowing that you are lying, telling people that you have been raped and kidnapped, taking advantage of people's empathy and sympathy towards you in the house of God?
In the house of God.
In the house of God, you would even go up and lie and put other people's lives at risk. It just blows my mind that people would go that low. And I still don't understand what the motive was behind this.
Right. And, you know, sometimes in these cases, you know, these women, they end up cheating on their boyfriends, their spouses, and they don't want to get caught. And what do they say? Oh, I was raped. And we don't know the specifics of this particular case, but that's a very plausible reason why she could have done something like this. But this is, historically, we've seen white women lie on black men, and white women are often believed far much more than black men, especially far more than black women. And so when a white woman who seems to be a damsel in distress says that she's been harmed, they immediately believe her. And we should always, and it's tricky because we should always believe victims.
You want to give victims the benefit of the doubt.
You want to give them the benefit of the doubt, but it's important to always give everyone the benefit of the doubt.
To do that work.
Proven until you're innocent until proven guilty. And we don't often uphold that in our justice system.
Well, to your point, Gerren, this comment comes from Tracia. She says, these lies have been going on forever, and the reason for many black men's lives, I assume she means being taken, and it's disgraceful. Mm. And one of the most common cases we have, if you recall this photo, I think it should be coming soon. If you don't know that woman's name, her name is Carolyn Bryant. Mm-hmm. Carolyn Bryant is responsible for the accusation against young Emmett Till, a young boy visiting the South from Chicago, mm-hmm. that he supposedly whistled at her or said something inappropriate to her, and he was later brutally tortured, beaten, mm-hmm. murdered, and thrown into a river, you know, attached to a tire, you mm-hmm. know, I mean, his body was so badly beaten and bruised that his mother chose to have an open casket funeral so people could see what was done to her son. Mm. And this all came out of this allegation from Carolyn Bryant, who many years later admitted that she made it up.
Yes, decades later.
And it's just, you have to know this history. Yeah. It gives you context for why when we hear stories like this about the girl from Texas, 18 years old making up these lies, just the danger that it puts people in and entire communities in, and the trauma that that brings back up from years of lynchings.
Yeah.
So many of the lynchings that happened on U.S. soil were justified, quote unquote, because of rape allegations, mm-hmm. which more often than not were not true.
Right. And keep in mind, she intentionally said three black men. She could have just said she was raped by three men. And so she intentionally infused race because she understands the racial implications and the racial history of in America. So she knew exactly what she was doing. And this is not the first time this has happened. And we have to speak, we have to talk more about race, because race is a very unsolved problem in America. We think that because slavery was abolished, that Jim Crow was abolished, that somehow racism is like not really here. It hasn't gone anywhere. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know, is reincarnated in different ways.
Unfortunately. Well, Pamela Whelan says people have been killed because of lies like this, and this is true. Tori Anthony says, no respect. I pastor, and people often ask why I don't jump to help people like this, because you never know. Tori's like, stay woke, just in case, you never know. Ivory Scott says she got away with lying on Emmett, but she didn't get away from God.
Amen.
Ultimately, there will be some justice.
The final judge.
And a new commenter, she says, how sad. Well, all we can hope for is that, again, you know, kudos to the police for doing a diligent job of doing their, you know, thorough sort of investigation to figure out that this story wasn't true. Mm-hmm. And they actually posted a statement up on their Facebook page. They said, Brianna Harmon Talbot's hoax was also insulting to our community and especially offensive to the African-American community due to her description of the so-called suspects in her hoax. The anger and hurts caused from such a hoax are difficult and all so unnecessary. So, again, many lessons to be learned, but, you know, if you're lying, chances are we're going to find out, we're going to find you.
Amen.
As they
Don't
say.
Don't do it again.
All right. Well, another story going into the SMH Hall of Fame actually happened right here in New York City. A white supremacist came from Baltimore riding the Bolt bus just for the purpose of killing African-American men. If you don't believe it, this is not fake news. This happened right here in New York City. This man, he murdered Timothy Kaufman, 66-year-old Timothy Kaufman, completely innocent, just walking down the street. Now, his name is James Jackson, the white supremacist who rode the Bolt bus up to New York City from Baltimore. And he said that he, quote, wanted to make a statement. And he brought a knife and a sword with him and, again, just randomly attacked Timothy Kaufman. He didn't know him. There was no sort of connection, and stabbed him to death with a sword. Such a tragic, tragic story that it's hard to believe. But police are saying that Jackson harbored ill will towards African-American men for a long time. He didn't like the idea of interracial relationships, and that he came to New York City to basically murder black men, and he also followed alt-right websites on YouTube, those types of videos. I mean, my heart hurts just reading this story, because I think about, you know, that could have been my father,
yeah.
same age, you know, just in New York visiting, and his life could have been taken for no reason.
Yeah. I still get really emotional about this story because, as you said, that could have been my father, that could have been my uncle. I mean, it could have been me. I mean, he was targeting black men. It wasn't a particular age. And he targeted New York because he wanted the attention. He wanted to be like a martyr for this alt-right racist movement. And I can't believe in 2017 that this is what we're seeing. It's no different. It's very similar to Dylan Roof, who killed 9 people in the AME church in Charleston, South Carolina. You know, and he was much younger. You know, these white men from the fringes of society are, you know, starting to boil up old wounds, racial wounds. And where did we go? You know, it's like, when we report these stories, we say it's wrong, we say it's bad, and it seems like no one's doing enough. Our politicians don't seem to care as much, at least not the right. Mm-hmm. And they try to ignore racism as if it doesn't exist. And then we get stories like this, and it's like, we're not crazy. And that's why I get so emotional, because it impacts me, it impacts the people that we love and care about, the people that we write these stories and publish these stories for. It's just, I'm never speechless on this show, but I'm speechless because it just doesn't make any sense. And this man was so, he has so much love. You know, I was looking at the pictures of him with celebrities. He lived life to the fullest. You know, he wasn't a wealthy man. He just wanted to spread love and spread joy. And of all the people he could have killed, he killed someone who seemed to be one of the most amazing people who ever lived. And we want to make sure that we honor him, and that people, definitely make sure you go to Twitter and check out his Twitter account.
Yeah, yeah. He had all these pictures. He met celebrities and would post them from his Twitter. And you'd just see how excited he was every time he met them. It's definitely one of those things that it hits you right here.
Yeah. I hope they throw the book at him.
Oh,
I hope he goes to prison for the rest of his life.
Well, you know, this comment, good to see you, Carmen. Thanks for checking in today. Carmen says, I really need to see white women come out strong against this. If they want solidarity, they need to show it. This type of thing has happened too many times, and it's one of the many reasons that it's hard to trust. Mm. And, you know, with the Dylan Roof case that you brought up, he said he wanted to start a race war. And, excuse me, I think one of the most powerful things was white and black people coming together saying, no, that's not going to happen.
Right.
But it takes people on both sides speaking out and condemning this, saying it's unacceptable.
Yes. We always, the history of race in America always had allies, and we mm-hmm. need our white allies to speak up more and more now than ever.
Absolutely. We have some more comments in our stream here. I don't know if you want to check some of them out as well.
Mark Cummings says, the police didn't even want to arrest this sick terrorist, and he turned himself in, admitting to the killing. Dylan Roof got breakfast. The cop in South Carolina who shot Walter Scott in the back has yet to be convicted. And so he's bringing up another case mm-hmm. that had racial implications. But he mentioned the Dylan Roof thing about getting breakfast. They took him to Burger King,
yeah.
I'm not sure if those police officers ever were reprimanded for that. Like, when did we start taking criminals or suspected criminals, because we know he wasn't convicted yet,
mm-hmm.
to get food after an arrest? It's unheard of.
Yeah. Well, you know, actually, you bring up a really great point for our commenter mm-hmm. who mentioned terrorism. You should know about this case. The assistant district attorney here in New York said that they are considering additional charges on a grand jury level for this murder, and that this was an act most likely of terrorism. Mm. And I think that's really powerful to call terrorism terrorism,
yeah.
right? Because it's often so racialized,
right.
and, you know, unfortunately, Muslims become the target or stereotyped to be terrorists.
Right.
But terrorism happens right here in this country, and this
and
is
most
an
of
example.
The mass shootings that happen here are by white men, not Muslim people.
One more fact for you guys to know about this story, that the man who perpetrated this crime, only 28 years old, again, just ridiculous, but he served in the U.S. Army from 2009 to 2012. Mm. So he was somebody who was a part of the military as well, and often bragged and boasted about that. Erica Davis says prayers going up, and I agree that we definitely want to send prayers to the family in this case, but
yeah.
I hope that we start to really pay attention to the signs of these shootings and these attacks being planned out, because now all of this evidence is coming out showing that this guy was a huge supporter of alt-right
right.
and white supremacy.
All this intelligence gathering that we do, Why are we not catching this before it happens?
Absolutely. All right. Well, we are almost at the end of the show today. Thank you so much for staying with us and giving your comments.
Yes.
We're going to do a couple political updates for you so you can know what's going on, because some really tense things are expected to happen today.
Yep.
And they have to do with health care, and they have to do with the vote. Mm-hmm. And your president's been tweeting a lot. He has a lot to say.
Still. He never stopped.
So we want to hear your thoughts on this one. All right, what's going down today with the health care?
So today, President Trump is hoping that he can get the American Health Care Act, which is supposed to replace
Trumpcare,
that's supposed to replace Obamacare. He wants a vote today, and if he doesn't get a vote, they're still hoping to postpone the vote. But Republicans cannot agree on this bill. Conservative Republicans feel like this bill is just Obamacare light, that it doesn't do enough for their conservative values. But then moderate Republicans are saying no for a different reason. They're scared because their constituents have been calling them and emailing them, telling them, do not vote for this bill. And they're scared that they're going to lose their seats if they support this bill, because it could cause premiums to go skyrocket. And so there's different, this healthcare bill, healthcare in general is very complicated and is very complex, but there are very central issues here. And Republicans can't seem to find common ground. And even if it does pass in the House, Senate Republicans say that they're not going to vote for the bill. And so it's going to go back to the House. And so it's very unlikely that this bill in its current form is going to go anywhere. But President Trump, he's saying, if you don't vote for this bill now, I'm moving on. Meaning he's not going to sign the bill if it goes to the Oval Office. Instead, he'll focus on tax reform and immigration, two other cores of his campaign that he promised to his base.
So he's playing hardball, guys. Yeah. He's playing hardball. We want you to take a look at these tweets that President Trump tweeted out today. He said, after 7 horrible years of Obamacare, skyrocketing premiums and deductibles, bad health care, this is finally your chance for a great plan. 29,000 people like that. 29,000 people agreed. He says, we are taking action to hashtag repeal and replace Obamacare. Contact your rep and tell them you support AHCA. Hashtag pass the bill. 34,000 people like that tweet.
Mm.
Are you guys supporting President Trump's healthcare bill? Are you going to be calling your reps to support him on this? Or do you think Obamacare should stay in place?
Ivory Scott Sr. doesn't comment about the health care bill, but he says 45 and his entire administration need to be impeached immediately.
Well, and so this is a running thing. Agree with you on that, Ivory.
Yeah. So we don't know what's going to happen. It doesn't look like it's going to be a vote today. And again, even if there's a vote, it's not going to go through. And this is not so good for President Trump, because he's the art of the deal. He's the deal maker.
The great negotiator.
And if you can't negotiate with your own party, like I said yesterday, how good of a business dealer are you?
Well, if you want to know any more about your president's mindset, if you haven't gotten enough just yet, if you feel like you don't know him well enough, you should take a look at this new article from Time Magazine, where they did an interview with the president. And, you know, there are many quotables that come out of this. The focus is on truth, and is truth dead? And he answers a bunch of questions about, you know, the wiretapping in the Middle East and whether or not you can trust what he says. I think one of my favorites to come out of here is when he says, I'm the president and you are not.
He did. At the very end of the interview, you can tell things were getting tense. The longer the interview had gone, the more frustrated he became. And because he was being questioned on many things he said throughout his presidency so far, many things that have been debunked, that have been deemed false. And he sticks to his guns. He doubled down on most things he said. Whenever the reporter would bring up things that weren't true, he would say, oh, but I read it in the newspaper. It was in the newspaper, so it's not my fault that it happened to be wrong. But this is the same man that cries fake news whenever things are reported bad about him. And so he picks and chooses when he wants to believe media and not believe media. But remember when he was running for president, during the primaries, he said that Senator Ted Cruz's father was with Lee Harvey Oswald, who assassinated President John F. Kennedy. And this was a conspiracy theory that ran in the National Enquirer, of all the tabloids and of all the media to quote. He quoted the National Enquirer. And in this interview, the reporter brings it up and he sticks to his gun. He says, no, no, I like Ted Cruz. He's a friend of mine, but that was in the newspaper. I didn't say that. I was referring to a newspaper. A Ted Cruz article referred to a newspaper story and had a picture of Ted Cruz, his father, and Lee Harvey Oswald having breakfast.
Well, Jonathan Cowan says in the comments, the transcript of the interview is astonishingly incoherent.
It's astonishing. Like, if you guys have not read it, seriously, when you get off Grio Live, go look at this interview. I've never read anything like it. I really am concerned for not just this country, but the president's psychological well-being. It's clear this man doesn't have it all together. And this is the man leading the country. This is the man who's supposed to be getting Congress together and helping pass legislation. And he doesn't seem to, he's very egomaniac. He just wants to be right. Even if he's really wrong, even if he's caught red-handed, he will always deny, deny, deny. He never wants to submit, if you will.
Donald Storr, good to see you back in our comments. And Donald says, I thought 45 had a replacement, just like he was supposed to have a strategy to defeat ISIS. Mm. Golfing and quitting must be more important, I guess. A little shade throwing going on in the comments there. Thank you, Donald.
They're fired up in these comment sections.
They're fired up today. Charlene is back. She says, Obamacare needs to stay in place, but something does need to be done on the premiums. And so that sort of speaks to what we were talking about yesterday. What you were saying is that, you know, Obamacare was a start, but it certainly wasn't a perfect bill to begin with, and there can definitely be improvements.
Right. We're all for amendments. I think that's that's the history of, like, legislation. You pass a bill, and it may not work out, and then you make some adjustments. But to want to repeal it completely is all political. They don't want Obama to be attached to such a landmark legislation. And so they'd rather just get rid of it, and they'll put American on it because make America great, right?
Yeah.
It's all political, but we'll see how things fall out.
Hashtag it's all political. Well, we thank you so much for your time today. We've reached our time. We appreciate you spending your lunch with us and chatting it up.
Yeah.
Love your comments. As always, go to thegrio.com to check out these articles and make sure that you share them online. That is where the strength is in telling the stories. The more people that see them, the more important conversations we can have. Before we leave, though, let's throw up that photo one more time. For you to check it out.
I love this picture. Now, remember, guys, I want you guys to come up with some really good captions here. Let's see if anybody comes up with anything. Because there's a series of pictures of this. He was actually meeting with CEOs of truck companies. Mm-hmm. And so he got into a truck, and I guess that was him being playful. But the pictures actually are quite hilarious. He looks, you know, well, he looks funny. I'll leave it there.
Make America old and gray again.
Dang, Tasha, that was good.
I'm just describing what I see in the photo. Make America old and gray.
I see gray.
That's what I see.
Old, white, and gray.
I think they're like, Donald, we need you to come out calmly or we're going to have to pull you out. Just calm down, Donald. Oh, my goodness. Sometimes it feels like I live in
the twilight zone. Shout out to Jonathan. Jonathan just said, great job today as always, guys.
Oh, thank you.
Commenters too, because you guys are really the show, and you guys make it a great show every single day. And that's why we do this. We do it for you.
We do this for you all. We wish that there was more representation of these stories across the media, but we're doing our part to make sure that you guys keep talking. Big shout out to Jonathan. I've known him actually since the fourth grade.
Aww.
He's one of the wokest friends that I have.
Yes.
Well, we are at our end. Mm-hmm. We wish you a great weekend, and we look forward to seeing you on the next episode of The Grio Live.
Yeah, see you on Monday.
Bye.